Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath School lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and they come in batches that are designed for three-month periods. This particular series of lessons, entitled The Teachings of Jesus, is for the months of July, August, and September of 2014. And this particular lesson is lesson number 9 out of that series, entitled Our Mission. What does Jesus have to say about our mission? Well, that's what we'll try to discover in our lesson today. So I hope you have a Bible handy, because we will be looking at a lot of texts in the Bible. And if you have your Bible handy, and even if you don't, we'd ask you to bow your heads with us now as we begin with a word of prayer. Our loving Father, it's a great privilege to sit together and talk about you and perhaps learn about you, and especially learn about what your son did when he was here on this earth. We look at the Gospels as the supreme evidence of what you are like, and now may we learn from them what we need to know and how we can better live our lives, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. The mission of the church. That has been the subject of many, many discussions down through the ages. And over the ages, it has changed. The idea of what the church was supposed to do has changed. And I wonder if you were just asked off the cuff to say, well, what's the mission of the church? What would you say? And would it be fair to say that our mission is supposed to be the same as Jesus' mission? Or was his mission different? Now, there are many people who say, well, no, Jesus' mission was to come and die and thus offer the sacrifice that pays for our sins, and none of us have anything to do with that. Well, there's a reason to question that, and not that there's anything wrong with that, but it's a reason to question it as being complete, as we will see in this lesson. Jesus clearly intended for his disciples to carry on the mission which he had started, and to pass that testimony along to, as in the form of good news, to all their followers. And we're still carrying that message as his followers and believers to our day. Well, what did Christ really intend to teach by his death and his resurrection? What did he want to say about the spreading of the gospel to the world, to all his faithful followers? And you know, there's a couple of passages that are pretty clear on that. Look at 1 Corinthians 15, 3 through 8, first of all. I passed on to you, and I'm reading from my Good News Bible, I passed on to you what I received, this would be Paul speaking, which is of the greatest importance, that Christ died for our sins, as written in the Scriptures, that he was buried, then he was raised to life 3 days later, as written in the Scriptures, that he appeared to Peter. By the way, Paul's talking about these things being written in the Old Testament. And sometimes I think we should sit down and challenge people to say, okay, where did you find that in the Old Testament? Did Paul have access to some scriptures that we don't have access to anymore? Well, then he appeared to Peter, Paul goes on to say, and then to all 12 apostles. Then he appeared to more than 500 of his followers at once, most of whom are still alive, although some have died. Then he appeared to James, and afterwards to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared also to me. This, of course, is Paul speaking again. Even though I am like someone whose birth was abnormal, for I am the least of all the apostles. And he goes on talking about his story and what he was trying to accomplish. Well, look at Acts 1, and let's go to verses, I would probably look at 4 and 5. And when they came together, he gave them, this is Jesus and his last time with them, he gave them this order: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift I told you about, the gift my Father promised. John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. And what difference would it make to be baptized with the Holy Spirit? Well, as Seventh-day Adventists, we tend to hold the writings of Ellen White in great respect. I particularly feel that she has given us an enormous number of insights which are of great benefit to us. She had this to say about the mission of Jesus, which is quite different than what people often suggest. The law of Jehovah was burdened with needless exactions and traditions. This is, of course, when Jesus was here. And God was represented as severe, exacting, revengeful, and arbitrary. What kind of, would you like to go to heaven and live with a God who was severe, exacting, revengeful, and arbitrary? Doesn't sound too like too much fun, does it? He was pictured as one who could take pleasure in the sufferings of his creatures. Try to imagine that. How would you like to live with a God who would love to see us enjoy seeing his creatures suffer?
It sounds like the doctrine of eternally burning hell.
Would you believe it? The very attributes that belong to the character of Satan, the evil one represented as belonging to the character of God. So Satan is saying, I know what I'm really like, and I want you to think that God is like that. Jesus came, therefore, to teach men of the Father, to correctly represent him before the fallen children of earth. Angels could not fully portray the character of God, but Christ, who was a living impersonation of God, could not fail to accomplish the work. The only way, now that's why I'm quoting this, notice he doesn't say, well, one of the better ways or a possible way, she says, the only way in which he could set and keep men right, that would be justification and sanctification. The only way he could set and keep men right was to make himself visible and familiar to their eyes. Did he accomplish that by his mission here on earth?
Well, he said he did.
He said he did.
John 17.
Yeah.
Does that mean the life of Jesus is of utmost importance? The life, we're to look at the life as well as the death.
Right.
And what is it? Remember in Romans 5:10, he says, we are healed with his life. Mm-hmm. Many times the translation says saved, but really means healed. And how does that heal? He heals our thinking, mm-hmm. clarifies our understanding of how God is, because it's our thinking that needs healing most of all.
And so what she's saying here is that the mission, the only mission of Christ, was to correctly represent God. And of course, that would include himself, as well as the Father and the Holy Spirit. He says, she says about him, that his purpose to come here was to tell us the truth about God.
Well, is that why Jesus said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father?
Exactly. So, going on, Christ exalted the character of God, attributing to him the praise. Now, he's no longer severe, arbitrary, exacting, revengeful. He attributes to him the praise and giving to him the credit of the whole purpose of his own mission on earth. Before we said it was the only purpose. Now she says it's the whole purpose of his own mission on earth. What would that be? To set men right through the revelation of God. So how would you say that in modern words? How would we describe that? To set men right through the revelation of God.
Well, if you say, as man thinketh, so is he. Mm-hmm. So we are, it's our thinking that has to be correct, or improved, and so forth, healed. And with that, then we can go on and apply what we learned from
them. Yeah, very good. In Christ was arrayed before men the paternal grace and the matchless perfections of the Father. She's saying, when we looked at Jesus, when we see what Jesus was like, when we see his behavior here on this earth, we are seeing God in reality. If the Father had come down, she says this in another place, that I may know him, page 338. If the Father had come down instead of the Son, it would have been, what we saw would have been not one bit different. Now that's very different than what many other churches, many other religions teach. Particularly pagan religions teach that gods have to be appeased, you have to do something to get him to not destroy you, all this kind of stuff. No, that's not what Christ said at all.
My sister gave me the New Testament without the Old Testament because the New Testament had Jesus who was not like the God of the Old Testament.
Yeah.
So,
we're going to look at that.
You're going to look at that. Okay.
Yeah, just hang on. We got some things to say about that in a little bit. In his prayer, this is Christ's prayer again, I'm reading. In his prayer just before his crucifixion, he declared, I have manifested thy name. What does that mean?
Revealed, demonstrate.
Yeah, and that name in ancient times meant your character. Christ had lived a perfect example of the Godhead. I have glorified thee on the earth. I have finished the work which thou gavest me to do. Now, if you believe that the work of Christ, the one work he came to do, was to die to pay for our sins, he hasn't done that yet. So how could he say, I have finished the work which you gave me to do? Well, clearly this is a different picture. When the object of his mission was attained, the revelation of God to the world, there she says it again. The Son of God announced that his work was accomplished and that the character of the Father was made manifest to men. That's an absolutely incredible piece of writing.
Who writes like that?
Yeah, tell me.
And sadly, that is rarely quoted.
Yeah. Well, you can see I've got references here, and these are all from original periodicals more than 100, 115, 120 years ago, and nobody has quoted it since. Why?
Except once.
Yes, this is true. Okay. Well,
then the image, the knowledge of God was entirely corrupted. We had a corrupted hard disk in our heads on what God was when Jesus came. And yeah. Jesus came to correct our computer and say, this is who God is, not who you have in your mind.
Yeah. Well, I would like to invite you to go to our website. If you found that quotation very interesting and provocative, go to our website at theox, that's theox.org, and download this particular handout and look for yourself. And then if you have access to the original writings of Ellen White or the very nice little disc that's available now for a very cheap price, you can look it up. And look at the context, look everything yourself. But I can tell you that this is quoted correctly.
Something stood out to me. As Christ followers, it's our duty to kind of represent God correctly. Mm-hmm. And in this quote, it says, angels could not fully portray the character of God. Does that mean there was a learning curve for them as well?
Absolutely. Absolutely. There still is. And think about this. I mean, we often don't think about this, but in this group, we try to paint a bigger picture. God doesn't intend for us to stop learning after 7 years or 80 years. I'm already past the 7 years. God doesn't intend for us to stop learning. He plans for us to learn for the rest of eternity. And the angels are learning for the rest of eternity. So we're just barely getting started. Yeah, very good point.
Of course, this earth was created for the purpose of teaching the angels.
Mm-hmm.
Because the angels, they had Michael teaching them, but he had to do this, Earth's
after the
blue
war.
Ball that we live on called planet Earth, in order to help reinforce and bring fully demonstrate that what had been said in heaven was true.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Are you saying that the angels had a misconception of God or did not know God fully?
How many quotations would you like to demonstrate that?
The answer is yes, they had not.
Yeah, many people think that, all the angels, they have it all figured out, they live with God, they know all the answers. No, Ellen White says very clearly, and I could show you passages from the Bible that seem to suggest that, no, they didn't have it figured out so clearly. Look, for example, at Ephesians 1 and Ephesians 3 and Colossians 1. Look at those characters. It says carefully, it says there, if we don't have time to look at them right now, but it says very clearly there that, you know, God intends for this world, and as well as 4:9, this world is the theater of the universe. By theater, it means the place where the action is. This is where everybody's watching. The whole universe is watching to see what's going on and what they can learn about God. And that's what it says in those passages that I just quoted. What the angels are supposed to learn about God comes through God's dealing with the human family, with the church.
The angels are susceptible to deception.
Mm-hmm.
A third of them were deceived.
Yeah.
And then they committed themselves to that deception and started on this earth with Eve being deceived.
And the two-thirds that didn't choose to side with Satan still had some questions in their mind until the cross.
That's right.
And I would tell you that if you go to the chapter, it is finished in Desire of Ages, it will say that even after the cross, they still had questions. So they're still learning. So we've got lots of exciting things to learn still.
Well, you know, when you, like you have a friend, a husband, a wife, or whatever, and you are just in good times, you get to know their personality. But when rough times hit is when you really get to know that person. Mm-hmm. And God, living in a perfect heaven, he hit rough times with the war in heaven, and the angels are seeing how God operates under pressure. With that?
Yeah. In a difficult situation. Well, what does God intend for us to do? Let's be very clear. Look at Matthew 5, starting with verse 14. I'm going to read 14 to 16. You are the light of the whole world. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. No one lights a lamp and puts it under a bowl. Instead, he puts it on the lampstand where it gives light for everyone in the house. In the same way, your light must shine before people so that they will see the good things you do and praise your Father in heaven. So Jesus came, he lived his life and died his death to teach us the truth about who?
God.
God. So we're supposed to live our lives to do what?
Do the same.
Demonstrate the truth about God if we can, to the extent we're able. Obviously, we're not going to do it to the extent in the same way that Jesus did, but that's what we're supposed to do.
And we can't do that till we know the truth about God.
That's right. You can't reflect the truth about God until you know the truth about God. Yeah. Well, there are multiple passages in the Bible suggesting that God is light. Jesus himself said, I am the way, the truth, the light, okay, life, and so forth. We need to be abundantly clear that we are not lights ourselves. We can only reflect light from God. Look at a couple of verses on that one real quick. Look at Ephesians 5, verse 8. You yourselves used to be in the darkness, but since you have become the Lord's people, you are in the light. So you must live like people belonging to the light. For it is a light that brings a rich harvest, and so forth, going on. And one other passage, look at 1 John 1, verse 7. But if we live in the light, just as he is in the light, then we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, purifies us from every sin. How do we get purified from sin? Living in the light. Then we learn the truth about why Jesus came and lived and died, and therefore the blood. And when we talk about the blood of Jesus, what is that referring to?
Life.
Life given up in sacrifice by his death. He was trying to say something really important to us about sin.
Yes.
And about its consequences. Well, it is God's plan.
Is this saying that you can't be your own little light? And you can't purify yourself. You have to be the reflector of light and allow God to purify you, because of yourself you can do nothing.
It's like the little boy who comes in after playing in the mud puddle and tells mom he can clean himself up without any soap.
Uh-huh.
It is God's plan for us to study the scriptures, and especially the life and death of Jesus, until as we admire him, we become like him. And there are many verses in the Bible about that. Let me just look at a couple. John 1, verse 4. The Word was the source of life, and this life brought light to humanity. Okay? So he brought light to humanity. What came as a result of that? Look at verse 9, same chapter. This was the real light, the light that comes into the world and shines on everyone. So the light is supposed to shine on all of us. And then what? 2 Corinthians 4, verse 6. The God who said, out of darkness the light shall shine, is the same God who made his light shine in our hearts to bring us the knowledge of God's glory shining in the face of Christ. So if we have the light in our hearts, and our faces are shining with knowledge of God's glory, what would that do? Might that make us a light to the community, to those around us?
People who do have the knowledge of God, can you actually see in their face a certain light?
Well, that's a question. We know some examples. The classic example in Scripture is the case of Moses. After spending 2 40-day periods with God on the mountain, he came down and literally his face was shining so bright that he had to wear a veil for a while until the light apparently slowly faded.
I mean, today, it seems like...
You don't
like
think that could happen today?
Well, it seems like Christians have a certain look about them, a kindness in their eyes, but maybe I'm just, you know...
You wouldn't be biased.
No, what I'm saying is I think Christianity can show in your face.
Sure.
But I just asked if...
One's demeanor counts for a lot. People notice... Notice how you carry yourself, and whether you're cheerful or sad or grumpy. There's nothing worse with a holy grumpy Christian.
Yeah.
Do they say the eyes are the light of the soul?
Yeah.
Yes.
Or the window to the soul? Yeah. So if your soul is connected to God, you have a better window that shows.
I have the privilege of working at a low income clinic, not far from here. And I see a lot of people who have had really, really rough lives. And fairly often I pray with my patients. And now I have some that I'm sure that come in to see me just so I can pray with them. And, you know, they know. And I have people, I mean, and it's not related to what they're coming for. You know, and I'm not trying to set myself up as some kind of example, but I think that, you know, if we have the opportunity to do little things like that, people notice. Well, Ellen White has this to say on that comment about that general subject. This is from Thoughts of the Mount of Blessing, page 41, paragraph 1. If Christ is dwelling in the heart, it is impossible to conceal the light of his presence. Joanne, there's your answer. If those who profess to be followers of Christ are not the light of the world, it is because the vital power has left them. If they have no light to give, it is because they have no connection with the source of light. I think that's pretty blunt, don't you? Right to the point.
It's so elusive. You would think that scientists, especially Adventist scientists, would come up with a measuring device to measure the amount of light in you with how exacting Adventists are. Yeah. But it's a subjective. You kind of just know, you feel it. Intuition, I guess there's no gauge for intuition.
I think God doesn't intend for any of us to be judges, either scientifically or otherwise.
So does that mean on second service and Sabbath when the church is pitch black and they have the spotlight on the singer?
Yeah.
He's shining the light?
I don't know how well he's reflecting.
I think he's absorbing.
Okay. Well, try to imagine yourself now. You know, one of the things we talk about here, and maybe we should talk about it even more, is that as Christians, as Seventh-day Adventist Christians, preparing for the final events of this earth's history, we are going to need to be able to distinguish between the true and the false. And in order to do that, I don't know any better way to do that than to see, to read the Bible, to read the writings of Ellen White and so forth, and practice thinking like the devil and thinking like God. So that we can see, well, okay, this is the way he thinks, this is the way he thinks. We need to practice that. Well, try to imagine yourself as one of the disciples on crucifixion weekend.
I'd like to say that wasn't that even endorsed by God? Wasn't God frustrated once when he said your disciples, you're not wise, that the evil people are wiser than you, wise up? Mm-hmm. So as Christians, we need to be wise in the ways of good and what may be coming our way.
Yep.
Okay, so God even endorsed that we should have wisdom.
Yes. Well, again, try to imagine yourself with the disciples just after Jesus is crucified or just after he died. Where were they?
Petrified in the upper room.
Petrified is right. Behind locked doors, hidden away in a place they hoped nobody knew where they would be. And what were they doing? Were they trying to witness for Jesus? They were fearful, distressed, discouraged, perplexed. They knew Jesus had the ability to escape from his enemies. I mean, they had seen that happen a number of times, hadn't they? Jesus could just sort of disappear and where'd he go? You know, he's gone. They knew he had that ability, and they knew Jesus would have made a perfect king for the people of Israel. And there was no question in their mind, this man would be a perfect king. So how could he allow himself to be killed by the Romans? He was supposed to conquer the Romans. I mean, this is backwards, right?
They knew he was perfect, especially after he fed the 5,000 men.
Yes, not counting women and children.
Did it?
He could supply all their needs.
Didn't even dawn on them that he had raised others from the dead, that he just might raise himself?
And, I mean, the thing is that he told them four times that we have recorded. I'm going to Jerusalem. I'm going to die. Third day, I'm going to rise from the dead. Huh?
They didn't get it.
I'm going to Jerusalem. I'm going to die. Third day, I'm going to rise from the death. Huh? You know, it was so contrary to what they wanted to think that what Jesus was going to. They knew on that trip up from Jericho to Jerusalem, just before that Passover week, they knew with all the crowds around him and celebrating, and then on that triumphal entry into Jerusalem, there was not a doubt in their mind but the fact that Jesus was just ready to be crowned king. They knew he was going to be king.
And a week later, the opposite.
Yeah. Then suddenly, on the third day after he was crucified, he appeared alive and well in the upper room, having passed through locked doors and walls.
You mean they were still there 3 days later?
I'm sure they thought they were seeing a ghost. Mm-hmm. I mean, how does this happen? But slowly recovering from their shock, they begin to realize that Christ had a very different plan than the one they had been trying to follow. He was commissioning them to be his witnesses, but he told them to wait for something. What was it he told them to wait for? You remember?
The Comforter, or what did he call it?
What? Why would they need to wait for the Comforter?
They definitely needed comforting.
He wasn't going to be there.
Yeah.
He was bringing the comforter to take his place.
Okay, to take his place, okay.
They were still 11 men plus some other associates that were not unified in mind and direction. Mm-hmm. They were going in every different direction.
Competing with each other.
Competing and... they needed to have one goal in mind.
So the Holy Spirit needed to do something for them.
Did they know what the Comforter was? Did they have any idea?
Well, apparently Jesus spent a lot of time talking about it that last night. He was with them. You go read through John 14, 15, 16. He spent a lot of time talking about it. So I don't know whether...
And we have just the outline.
Yeah, we just have nothing but the outline. Well, the Holy Spirit did some other things for them. One thing he did, which was quite remarkable, he gave them the power. If you read through the book Acts of the Apostles, he gave them the power to travel anywhere in the world and speak fluently the language of the people where they were traveling. That just blows me away to think about it.
Did God make all the languages at the Tower of Babel? And he...
We sort of have to assume that. We don't know exactly how that all happened. One day we'll see it on live 3D.
And then he gave those languages to his followers. Yeah.
Well, they learned that they had to set aside their own personal differences because they had to come forth from that room with a common goal. God says, by the time you walk out that door, you need to be so united and so clear about what your goal is that you're willing to die for it. That's really what he was saying.
Uh-oh, is that our mission as we walk out of the church?
You're trying to jump ahead of me.
Oh, okay.
Well, Christ had already sent them on several missions, going through Galilee. You remember, if you read that, there are three different times it specifically says Christ sent them out all over Galilee to preach in two by two, to preach in the villages and areas around and so forth. And then they would come back together and they would sit down and mull over what had happened. And then a little while later, Jesus sent them out again and mulled over and sent them out again. And then finally, when it wasn't even safe for him to travel around in Galilee anymore, he was traveling across the Jordan River in Perea, on the other side of the Jordan, and that time he sent out 72. And who were they preaching to over there on the other side of the Jordan?
Samaritans and others. A mix.
It was quite a mix.
Well, they certainly didn't have that picture a few months later.
No.
Did they? They were still just the Jews.
I think they thought that's what they were doing, is just speaking to Jews. But Jesus intentionally set them up in situations where there would be other people listening in.
Today, God is sending us out, and we're taking a satellite with us. Mm-hmm. And he sends us there, and we take a satellite.
Yeah.
So.
Well, he gave them power and authority to do the same work he had been doing. Does God want us to do that same work? Seems like it, doesn't it?
And the work was showing the character of God.
Correctly representing the truth about God. Yeah. To show that he was telling us the truth when he said that sin leads to death. In contrast to Satan's claim that it doesn't. Just as a starter. Well, look at John 20, verse 21. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father sent me, so I send you." What does that imply?
Our mission should be the same.
Jesus got kicked out of heaven, and so Jesus is kicking us out of Jerusalem. No, I don't think that's what he means. What does it mean, maybe, that we have the same mission that Jesus had?
Yes.
Sounds like it, doesn't it? As the Father sent me, so send I you.
I like the next sentence. It says, "Then Jesus breathed on them and said, receive the Holy Spirit."
Yep.
So before we go out, we need to get the breath of God to give us his character and success.
And I'm going to say, you brought us to it, so I want to nail it right here. You think the Holy Spirit would bless us to give a wrong message? He's not going to bless us to tell something that's not true about God. He's going to bless us when we are telling the truth about God, right?
So what are we to say about all the, quote, evangelists, end quote, that we think are preaching the wrong message and are very successful?
Well, what I would say about that is, how do you measure success?
In terms of people responding, at least at the time.
You can have, Jim Jones was very charismatic, and he led a whole bunch of people to Guyana, and they died.
Yeah.
And I'm not trying to equate any Adventist evangelist or any modern evangelist from any churches with that, but unfortunately, well, I once had someone who was a trainer of pastors say this to me, and I thought about it a lot, and I think it has some real merit to it. He said, we should measure the success of a pastor or an evangelist not based on how many people he baptizes, but how many people are brought into the church and baptized by the people he baptized.
Grandchildren instead of children.
Yeah. Well, Jesus' whole prayer in John 17, he says, first of all, he prays for himself. Then he prays for his disciples. And then he prays for all those who believe because of their testimony. Who would that include?
Everyone.
Us.
It better include all of us if we want to have a part in his kingdom. How often has God been grossly misrepresented by people claiming to preach the truth about him? Ellen White says in one place, there are 1,000, yet millions of skeptics and infidels because of what has been preached from the pulpit.
Certainly that's not the Seventh-day Adventist pulpit, is it?
Must
be some other pulpit.
Must be some other pulpit somewhere. Seventh-day Adventists have often seemed to suggest that we can convert as many people as possible, making them members of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and when we do, our mission will be accomplished, right?
Is there
something more than that?
Yes. Because there are people who are becoming Seventh-day Adventists in certain parts of the world and who are doing all kind of things. They think it's okay to kill people because they don't like something they do, and they're beating their wives, beating their children. They have 3-4 wives, and they're being baptized at Adventists.
Hold on.
It's true.
So
they're parts of Africa.
They are not reflecting the character of God?
Not at all.
So success is training your people that you're baptizing to reflect the character of God.
Yeah. What should happen is everybody who is taken either by individually or by a pastor through a series of lessons and becomes convinced about the truth, the truths that basically the church believes and supports, once they finish that, when they're baptized, they ought to go immediately into a program where they go through the Bible with someone who understands the major issues in the Bible and says, okay, here's what the Bible teaches. Let's see what we can learn about God, reading the Bible, starting from Genesis all the way through to Revelation. What does this book say to us about God? And that would be an incredible experience if we really did that.
What's different about the Adventist Church is when you go through the book about God, every place I've been, they allow questions. And you go through the book to learn about God in some other churches, not a question can you answer. A room of 100 people sitting there for 3 hours, not a question could be answered. And that is most frustrating to one who always likes to ask questions.
I wonder who that would be.
So you can go through the Bible, but you should be able to go through the Bible and ask your questions.
Yep, exactly. Well, is it just possible that the reason the Holy Spirit has not come upon us in latter rain power, that we might not be correctly and accurately representing the truth that Jesus represented when he came to this earth?
That's quite a statement.
Well, I just asked a question. When a person in authority sends someone on a mission, it implies several things. One, you assume that the person who is sending somebody else has authority, right? Two, that there's a definite purpose for the mission. Hopefully, a person in authority isn't just wasting your time. And three, that the messenger can and is expected to accomplish, to go and do and accomplish the mission he sent for, right? Isn't that the obvious? I mean, if any of those things are not true, it's kind of a wasted mission, right?
I'd add number four.
Okay.
That the sender equips the sendee to accomplish the mission.
Yeah. I was sort of implying that by number three, that he knows what he's supposed to be doing. Okay. Well, look at John 20, verse 22. Then he breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive people's sins, they are forgiven. If you do not forgive them, they are not forgiven," so forth. But he said, receive the Holy Spirit. He breathed on them and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." Now, there's a predecessor to that verse found in Genesis 2, verse 7. Then the Lord God took some soil from the ground and formed a man out of it, and he breathed life-giving breath into his nostrils, and the man began to live. You think there's any parallel between those two passages? What's supposed to happen to the Christian when the Holy Spirit is breathed upon him?
Become alive.
Yeah.
More alive. Some religion sees that as the soul.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. There are those who teach that, you know, somewhere between conception and birth, that God actually breathes or infuses a soul into us, and that's why humans are different than animals. And we feel that that's not supported by Scripture itself, but people do believe that. Well, when ordinary human beings, let's think about what happens. God expects a transformation to take place. And what is included in that transformation? When ordinary human beings with their usual selfish ambitions and motives become servants of God, they will have a compelling desire to teach the world the truth about their loving Heavenly Father. What does it take to motivate people to take on that task? What kind of powerful evidence do we need to convince us that it is our task? The original disciples were transformed and motivated by what? The life, ministry, death, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And suddenly they were completely different people. When Jesus gave them permission to go make disciples, baptizing and teaching about the day after the day of Pentecost and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, they were ready. Well, what kind of a change took place in the disciples before the triumphal entry, between the time of the triumphal entry to Jerusalem and the Pentecost? Now, what did we suggest a little bit earlier? What were they thinking when Jesus triumphally entered Jerusalem?
We're going to be the government.
We're going to be the new government. Jesus is going to be the new king. And 50 days later, more or less, on Pentecost, it should have been 57 days later at Pentecost, what were they thinking? How would you contrast what they thought at that point? We have a mission. We have to tell the world what we have learned in the last few weeks about God and His mission and why He sent Jesus and what Jesus' life was all about, right?
Did those burning tongues coming down put a burning in their heart also and a burning in their tongue?
Well, I would like to suggest that the burning was already there. That's why the tongues could fit. I think that when people really come to understand and really grasp what the gospel is all about, the truth about God, they can't keep quiet about it.
And really, I suspect that pretty much all the building blocks were in place before the resurrection.
Yeah.
It was the 50 days afterwards that a paradigm shift, a rearranging their picture of God and what Jesus was and His mission and their mission. It was a total paradigm shift.
There was a thing called a fruit basket upset. A complete change. Oh, wow. And try to imagine, I suggested earlier, try to imagine yourself in the upper room as one of the disciples. Let me challenge you with a different question. Try to imagine yourself with your fruit basket completely upset. Everything's upside down, backwards. And all of a sudden you realize that this person that you've been walking with and talking with for 3.5 years was God. What would that do to you?
You begin to realize how dense you really were.
You didn't have to put it so bluntly.
Well, that's right. I mean, here he'd been telling them, you're the Son of God. And finally it takes them till that time till it began to sink in. It didn't fit their paradigm.
And Jesus said to them right there, I'm sending you where? To Jerusalem, to Samaria, and to the uttermost parts of the world, right? Right there. Jesus himself telling them that. Well, What happened 3.5 years later?
They finally started to go beyond Jerusalem.
Well, why did that happen? Remember the speech of Stephen in Acts 7? And you come to Acts 8, verse 1, and Saul, that would be the one later known as Paul, approved of his murder. But look at what comes next. That very day, the church in Jerusalem began to suffer cruel persecution. So why are they scattering? Why are they carrying the gospel to the world?
They're being chased.
They're being chased. Exactly. All the believers except the apostles were scattered throughout the provinces of Judea and Samaria. Some devout men buried Stephen, mourned for him with loud cries, but Saul tried to destroy the church, and of course then it goes on to talk about. So why did they finally decide to spread the gospel out?
What's unusual is they were persecuted, they spread out and ran, and then they started talking. Mm-hmm. They didn't spread out and run and shut up and just live quiet lives.
So, I told you, when you got the fire in your bones, you can't keep quiet. Well, there's another passage that's almost never read, but I want to focus on it right now. It's found in Acts 11, verses 19 to 21. Some of the believers who were scattered by the persecution, which took place when Stephen was killed, so it's very clear what it's talking about, went as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch. Now, this is in different countries now, okay? Telling the message to
Jews only.
There's 3.5 years later, who are they talking to?
Jews only.
But other believers who were from Cyprus and Cyrene, where's Cyrene?
Libya.
We now have the gospel coming from Libya. Well, not today, but in those days. These new believers went to Antioch. That's where Barnabas and Paul later worked, was their home church. Went to Antioch and proclaimed the message to Gentiles also, telling them the good news about the Lord Jesus. Here we have one of the most incredible changes to ever take place in terms of spreading the gospel. Now we're not going to just talk to Jews. We're going to spread the gospel to everybody. And who did it? We don't even know their names. And they came from Libya.
Their names
and
are
Cyprus.
Other believers. That's their names.
Mm-hmm. It's amazing. So the Lord's power was with them, and a great number of people believed and turned to the Lord. And what do you suppose happened as a result of that? Why do you suppose these believers who were from Cyprus and Cyrene were the first ones to begin openly preaching the gospel to the Gentiles?
Were there only Gentiles around them?
Well, mostly Gentiles around them. But probably it's because they didn't have the prejudices that the Judean believers had.
Do you think the other believers were Jews?
Yeah. I mean, these other believers here?
The other believers that spread it.
Maybe. Probably Jews, but they were Jews that were so accustomed to living in Gentile territories that they didn't have so many prejudices.
Yeah. I would suspect that they dealt every day with people who weren't Jews. Mm-hmm. And so they were comfortable talking to them, dealing with them. I got a great message to tell you.
Yeah. And what was the response from Jerusalem when this happened? The brethren said to Barnabas, you get up there fast and figure out what in the world is happening in that church up there. Right?
So you mean if we are a watered-down Christian or Adventist,
be careful now,
we can still spread the gospel to places maybe that Adventists don't go?
The brethren were so worried about what was happening in Antioch, they just had to find out for themselves. And Barnabas was sent up there to sort of check on things, and what did Barnabas do? He jumped in with both feet and he said, this is wonderful, let me be part of it. So he started doing it. He says, pretty soon, what did he do? He said, I can't do this by myself, I need some help, where's Paul? So he went and got Paul, and the two of them, and of course, these were the two people who a little while later, where they had their hands laid on them and blessed by the church at Antioch and said, go to the Gentiles.
Now, were the Gentiles told about Jewish history and the things they needed to know?
Okay. Are we as 21st century Adventists afraid to move out of our little ghettos to spread the gospel to the whole world? Well, there's a lot of Adventists who say, but I can't go. I have to support my family. I have to earn a living. I have to educate my children. I mean, how can I go? Well, you don't have to go. Every one of us has the opportunity to witness to someone around us. Well, look again at Matthew 28, 19 and 20, that famous passage. Go then to all peoples everywhere and make them my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you. And I will be with you always to the end of the age. Now, if you were reading this in Greek, you would discover something interesting. There's only one imperative, one command in that whole sentence. Now, we have retranslated it into English, so there's a whole bunch of commands. Do you think you can guess which one is the command?
Go.
No.
No?
I will be with you always?
No.
Obey?
No.
Teach. Okay.
Teach. No.
Teach them obey.
Baptize?
No. You only got one choice left.
What's left?
I missed it.
Make them my disciples is the only command. It says going to all peoples everywhere, making them my disciples, or make them my disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father and the Son, and teaching them. So all the rest of that going and baptizing and teaching is all in support of doing what?
Make them my disciples.
Make them my disciples. The single imperative in that whole thing is make them my disciples.
Well, you know, when you talk to people in the world today, they do not want to be God's disciples. What is it, what's in it for them to be God's disciples? They, you know, that really needs to be explained because, you know, what's in it for me? And they see.
And I can assure you, without going into details, that the way the gospel is preached in almost everywhere, it's about what's in it for me.
Some really good people don't want to be associated with Christians because the way they see God being represented. You watch on TV people acting, you know.
Well, look at Mark. He makes it pretty brief. Mark 16, verse 15, here right there on our screen. Go throughout the whole world and preach the gospel to the whole human race. Well, church members might read this and say, whew, good, I'm off the hook. I'm not a preacher. This doesn't apply to me. But actually, the word that's translated preach means to proclaim, to announce. There's nothing about preaching in behind a pulpit somewhere. It says, tell people, proclaim it. Well, following the Great Disappointment, almost 170 years ago, in 1844, those who were to become Seventh-day Adventists began to take another look at the three angels' messages. You know them, Revelation 12, 17, and along with some other parallel passages, Revelation 14, 6 through 12, but comparing that with Revelation 12, 17 or Revelation 19, 10. And they determine that God is looking for a very special group of people at the end of time. These are people who will carefully keep the commandments, understanding how God wants us to keep them correctly, and then we'll go out with that message to the rest of the world. Well, here's what Ellen White says about that commission. Remember, Matthew 24, 14 says, this gospel of the kingdom will be preached. It's a promise. Thus Christ gave his disciples their commission. I'm reading from Ellen White again. He made full provision for the persecution of the work, the prosecution of the work, and took upon himself the responsibility for its success. So long as they obeyed his word and worked in connection with him, they could not fail. The Savior's commission to the disciples included all the believers. It includes all believers in Christ to the end of time. How many does that leave out? It is a fatal mistake, to suppose that the work of saving souls depends alone on the ordained minister. The Zohar page is 822, paragraphs 1 and 2.
I bought a big case of great controversy. Mm-hmm. I love going out in the morning where the newsstands are and put one on the newspaper stand. For a person who likes to read the paper, I think here's something more interesting to read. Then pray that God will. And I'm so curious.
Someday you'll find out. Mm-hmm. I'm reading again from Ellen White, Desire of Ages, page 195. Every true disciple is born into the kingdom of God as a missionary. He who drinks of the living water becomes a fountain of life. The receiver becomes a giver. The grace of Christ in the soul is like a spring in the desert welling up to refresh all, making those who are ready to perish eager to drink of the water of life. If only we could figure out how to do that more successfully. The very life of the church, and that was Desire of Ages 195. I'm now moving on to Desire of Ages 825. We just have a moment or two left. The very life of the church depends upon her faithfulness in fulfilling the Lord's commission. To neglect this work is surely to invite a spiritual feebleness and decay. Where there is no active labor for others, love wanes and faith grows dim. Heaven stands indignant at the neglect shown to the souls of men. Would we know how Christ regards it? How would a father and mother feel did they know that their child, lost in the cold and the snow, had been passed by and left to perish by those who might have saved it? Would they not be terribly grieved, wildly indignant? Would they not denounce those murderers with wrath hot as their tears, intense as their love? The sufferings of every man are the sufferings of God's child, and those who reach out no helping hand to their perishing fellow beings provoke his righteous anger. This is the wrath of the Lamb. To those who claim fellowship with Christ yet have been indifferent to the needs of their fellow men, he will declare on the great judgment day, "I know you not whence you are. Depart from me, all ye workers of iniquity." Desire of Ages 825. In light of the passage of Signs of the Times, clear back in the beginning, in light of these passages we just read here, it should be incredibly clear that Jesus gave us our mission a long time ago. He lived that mission. We need to live that mission. There's no other way. This is the if we want to be a part of the final message to the world, we have to be there, and you should be there too. Thank you.